I love Star Trek, which is why I hate bad Star Trek. Fathers and sons in Star Trek. We've covered quite a few variations on this idea. We've had the really good father-son relationship. We've had the really bad father-son relationships. We've had father-son relationships that grew. We've had father-son relationships where the dad was dead. We've had the fill-in-the-blank meaning for this relationship, because J.J. Abrams never explained it, relationship. And now let's have another. This is POSTNG, the Icarus Factor. Whatever that means. Episode with the Enterprise on the way to a starbase for some minor repairs that they don't think is a big deal, but they want to make sure it's going to be okay.
Even if the molecular level controls have failed, we can still recrystallize the dilithium without outside help.
Don't worry, Data. My ego isn't at stake here.
Perhaps we can reprogram the system to correct the readout variables.
Thrill at the adventure of Star Trek! Picard has Riker meet him in private and they discuss his career.
I've just been recollecting the arrival of a new first officer on board the Enterprise, and a manual docking confidently achieved. I may have been somewhat miserly in my congratulations then, so let me make up for it now.
Yes, I was written quite poorly back then. Riker's been selected to captain the ship, the USS Ares.
Not for your military proficiency, but for your skill as an explorer.
Because being especially skilled at the non-military is perfect when captaining a ship named after the Greek god of war. So a civilian advisor at the starbase has been assigned to Riker to help him sort out whether he wants to take on this new captaincy or not. And who is this civilian advisor?
Dad.
And Riker is not happy with Dad. Okay. And then who shows up to pester Worf about gossip? Why, Wesley Crusher, of course.
Oh, God, not Wesley.
Yes. Wesley. He's prominent in this episode.
He was completely surprised.
So?
Maybe. Can you stop?
Your father?
I never knew my father.
And I didn't have a father long enough to know him.
It is a waste of time to think of such things.
I wasn't thinking about
father,
it.
I never knew my father.
When I said to stop doing that, I'm sure you're going to freak me out.
Enough!
Just rip his head off and throw it down a chute. No one would ever know.
Wesley survives, Kim. Meanwhile, in engineering, Geordi is taking all the repairs personally. Even though earlier he said that his ego was not at all at stake. Apparently, Geordi LaForge is a big fat liar.
I was just talking to Worf.
Yeah?
He's really eccentric at times.
It's one word for it.
Matt, can I,
Yeah. Oh, the corner thing. Okay. Well, let's go on back once more to Kim's Corner.
Does no one in the future understand what an introvert is? Worf doesn't want to talk to you. Just let it be. Leave the man alone. He's not hurting anybody. He's not even being rude until you keep poking him. Is there something about Starfleet that requires you not only to be professional, but chipper and chatty at all times? This is starting to remind me of all the forced socialization I had in high school. It didn't actually make me a more cheerful member of society. It made me resent it like hell. This is a counterproductive method of trying to get Worf to be friendly and sociable, guys. Knock it off!
Meanwhile, in 10 Forward, Miles O'Brien has invited himself over to Will Riker's table to help him sort out his personal problems.
What did I just say?
Female?
No.
Career? career?
Health?
Existential dread?
Lizards?
Tofu?
Purple?
Delta Burke?
Carrots.
Family. That is trouble.
And Dr. Pulaski meets up with Kyle Riker. Apparently they know each other. What's that you say? You don't know who Dr. Pulaski is? And you also didn't say anything because you're actually watching a computer screen? Well, no need. Let me explain. Gates McFadden left the show in season 2 and was replaced with Dr. Catherine Pulaski. Dr. Pulaski is basically Leonard McCoy, only in a female body, technically. She'll be gone by the end of the season and never mentioned again. For the most part, I find her inert, pointless, and occasionally slightly grating.
I know her too, but we don't do that.
We do purple.
And now Wesley is bugging Data.
Really? You try talking to Worf, Geordi. I'm telling you, he is not normal for Worf.
There is, of course, a genetic predisposition toward hostility among all Klingons, but Worf has been unusually out of sorts.
And he was dealing with Wesley Crusher. And so Geordi and Data send Wesley off alone to observe Worf.
Try constantly snapping your fingers right in front of his face, Wes. He loves that.
We find out that Dr. Pulaski and Kyle Riker are old friends. But Riker comes up and he still doesn't like his dad.
I'm ready for that briefing whenever you are.
Funny how he hasn't changed his opinion in the last 20 minutes.
Which is why this was such an important scene.
We could have been great together.
Face facts, Kyle. You're crusty. You have a reputation for being hard as nails and getting the job done. And then there's Will.
And there's Will.
And then there's Bart!
And then there's Hagrid!
He is simply lonely. We can relieve his anxiety through socialization.
And now Data has downloaded a Wesley Crusher app, apparently, because he tries the same thing with Worf.
Be gone!
And gets the same response, with the same level of pissing himself. Just a different fluid, apparently.
Do I not leak?
Not enough people nowadays say, be gone. It's like, seize him. It's a phrase we really need to bring back.
And Riker's in his quarters reminiscing when Worf comes in.
It is very difficult to say. Words are not always easy for me.
I love you. He wants to join Riker on the Ares if Riker decides to go.
I haven't accepted the assignment yet.
Could be a dangerous mission. There may be the potential for combat.
That is not the purpose of the mission.
Still.
Let's also not forget Wesley Crusher's on this ship.
Worf.
But Wesley!
You've made your point.
But Wesley!
Then I know you will do the right thing.
Wow, I can't believe I'm going to say this, but this was actually a good scene. Not really that much to mock. Kyle Riker shows up to visit his son.
I've been hearing some good things about you. Then why haven't I heard from you? I know, keeping in touch is not my strong suit.
That's a bad dad.
When your mother died...
Excuse me. I've got to study this mission briefing.
You haven't lost your touch, have you?
I like to help. When they heard, I heard.
Dr. Pulaski's greatest medical skill is her empathy.
Huh. Well, not to steal from SF Debris' observations, but...
Counselor Troy is going to need the comfort of a human touch and not the cold hand of technology. I'll give you credit for your vast knowledge, but your circuits would just short out if you were confronted with a truly original mystery. It does know how to do these things, doesn't it?
My name. It is pronounced Data.
Oh?
You called me Data.
What's the difference? I am not accustomed to working with non-living devices that... You're wasting your breath, Lieutenant. Saying that to Data is asking a computer not to compute. With all your neural nets, algorithms, and heuristics, is there some combination that makes up a circuit for bruised feelings? Your service record says that you are alive. Must accept that.
And then Kyle Riker meets with Troy.
Man, it's like annoying character palooza today.
If Lwaxana Troy shows up, I'm leaving.
I wouldn't blame you.